This National Professional Anglers Association video presentation is brought to you by Missouri Secrets Tackle and 241 Inc. Productions.
So my name is Jimmy Bell. I'm going to talk to you for my fourth time about pathway to professionalism. So hopefully I've got myself practiced up a little bit and you guys can put up with me. First thing I'm going to start with is a friend of mine. I was talking to him the other day. He's looking at coming into Alumacraft and he shared this and I had to share it because I liked it. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And we're going to talk about this through the professionalism is kind of working as a team and being with everybody. You can get someplace really fast going by yourself, but if you want to stay in it and be in it for the long term, do it together. So first let's start off and I'm going to kind of define when I'm talking about pathway to professionalism, what the difference is. So the professional is the individual, right? It's a person, it's a job, it's whatever it is. Professionalism is an act. It's how you do things, it's your integrity, your honesty, all those other things that come along with it. In my opinion, if you're good at being professionalism with what you do, it helps you to be a professional much quicker and easier than any place else. Now, this isn't always true. If we go into professional sports, we will find many professional sports people that don't have a whole lot of professionalism, but they're really, 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 really good at what they do. What I'm saying is if you've got professionalism, you will get to be a professional much faster. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about some things that I've seen over the years as we go through this. And the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to try and tie in more of my experiences through it. Doesn't mean it's right or wrong. What I'm sharing is what's worked for me. Integrity and honesty. Without these, your career will be short-lived. Sponsors, watch for this stuff, and it's easy for us. We will talk to each other. So if I got somebody that comes to me and wants to get on the Alumacraft team, I may go to Kevin at Evinrude and talk to him and say, hey, have you heard of this guy? What do you think? I saw him at some other stuff and he wasn't doing, he said he was going to work some shows, didn't work the shows. Honest integrity are huge and you will be short-lived. The industry will find out. And what I'm saying is the sponsors will notice. We pay attention to it. You should pay attention to it. It's a big piece of what's going on in this industry. You get to stay with longevity because you do what you say you're going to do. And as soon as you start breaking out of that, people realize that's not a good thing. Do what you say you are going to do. If you tell a sponsor you are going to work 45 days at shows, my advice, work 50 days at shows. Don't work 45. You work 35 or 40, guess what? They understand that and they look at it and go, I don't know. This guy said he was going to do something and he didn't do it. Never talk about what compensation you are getting. As you move up in the industry, you will find that the higher you go, the more compensation you're going to get, and there are going to be things in your contract that says you can't share that. And all of a sudden, if you've got somebody saying, I get a free boat, I get this, I get that, usually they're doing this, right? All of us, Tom, you've seen these people. I'm getting all this stuff, and I can guarantee you they're talking about that they're getting this, but they're getting this. But the more important thing to understand is the sponsor gets wind of that. You are done. It is a kiss of death. Always strive to be looked up to, not looked at. There are people in this industry that are, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. And the hard part is, all of us are here in this industry because we're guides, we're tournament anglers, we're whatever, right? We're all here to win. So we've all got a little bit of arrogance in us already. But if you're standing up there, look at me, look at me, look at me all the time, people are not looking up to you. There's a big difference. You want the people that are looking up to you, not necessarily just looking at you. We got a lot of people that it's me, me, me. People notice how you treat your family, others, and your faith. Be true to all three. I, as a promotional manager for Alumacraft, watch for people that have integrity. I watch how they treat their family. Are they spending time? Are they doing the right things? Are they saying derogatory things about their wife when they're not around? Their faith is another one that I'm watching. I'm not saying we all got to be Christians and everything else, but if I got a guy on stage just sitting up there, praise the Lord, And all of a sudden I watch and he's sitting at the bar and being an asshole the rest of the time. No thanks. Doesn't pay. Doesn't have to be with them. What's in it for me? People start to focus on themselves all the time. And what we need to realize is that it's not always about us. It's about building a team. It's about building a relationship. And the more you look at it as an individual, and I'm going to talk about this through the whole thing, you'll see I'll use some examples that make a big difference in this. Accomplishments get you noticed. Teamwork gets you and maintains a job. So what I'm saying here is, I was blessed when I started tournament fishing that I started out really good. In 94, I started fishing. My wife, Allie, actually talked me into it. I didn't think I could do it. I said, you know, there's no way I can compete against Parsons and Cavias and Perry Good and Roach and McClelland and all these guys. She said, you can. I believe in you. We're going to sign up for the whole tour. I went to the first event, and I took first place and won $25,000, my very first professional event. So what I'm saying is accomplishments helped me right away, right? I was lucky. I was blessed that I got that, and I kind of had some of those things right off the way. But it's the work ethics afterwards that have kept the job for me. Work to make everyone look good. I'll go through this in multiple ways, but I'll use an example here. A good friend of mine, Ross Garothi, I've been with Yamaha since 96. Ross started right about the same time, I think 97. We go down, say for instance, to a product release down at the test facility in Kennesaw. And Ross is there and I'm there. Obviously, I'm going to do a report, and we'll talk about reports in here as well. I think they're important. So I do a report on this event, and what I want to do is make sure that I talk about Ross as much as I talk about me. So we want to make each other look good in this, not the other. The other thing that happens is, if I help somebody go from here to here, and I'm here, guess what? The bar just got raised, right? Now all of a sudden I have the ability to really get to here. If this person is still here and I'm here, I can only get to there. That's the, if he's the top guy and that's the most that he's making, that's as far as I'm going to be able to get. When reporting, report the great work others do, just as I mentioned on the top. Keep everybody in the reports. Don't just make it about yourself. Take the whiff him out there. Congratulate each other on accomplishments. This gets touchy sometimes. So let's say Stephen wins a tournament. And he's in a Lund, and he's in a Mercury, and it's certainly much different than what I've got, right? Somebody shared a post, hey, Stephen just won this event in the Graha event. Congratulations. Well, I'm with Yamaha, and I'm with Alumacraft. Now I've got a dilemma, right? Because social media, everybody's watching. I go out there and start commenting on that. My sponsors are going to see that. Is that right? Absolutely, it's right. 100%. Some of the sponsors might not like it. I don't care. It's the right thing to do. We need to help each other through all this thing. If Newstrom is doing a great job and he has a great guide trip that he's caught the biggest fish in the world and just broke the state record, I want to get out there and make sure to congratulate him. Doesn't matter his sponsors. We build each other up. Understand your place and respect it. You are always going to have people that are below you, equal to you, and above you. And what we need to do is always treat all three of those with respect. There's a book called Gung Ho. It's an easy read. You can read it from Minneapolis to Denver on a flight. So it's a pretty small little book. It's a business book. It's nothing to do about fishing, but if you ever get a chance, read it. It's a true story. There was a lady. She was given a manufacturing plant. The parent company was this big boys club. And they got tired of this gal and they wanted to get rid of her. So they gave her this plant that she didn't know, but they knew was faltering and going to the ground. And what happened is she got in there and she's doesn't know what to do, finds out that she's in this no-win situation, but there's this one little group that's doing great in the company. And there's a Native American guy that's running it. And he started this process called Gung Ho, and it's about a squirrel, a beaver, and geese, believe it or not. And again, this is a true story. So she goes to him, finds out what that is. Well, the whole concept of it is the squirrel is doing all this work, right? They're going out and collecting nuts, and everybody's working together and getting all this stuff done. And it's, yeah, it's a pain in the butt to go collect nuts all the time, but it's an important job, and we better get it done, or we're going to die. We need to have all these nuts for the winter. The beaver is about, you've taken a log and you've put it over in this corner to plug that hole. I'm not going to go over and grab that log and bring it over here and put it in another spot. I trust that you knew what you were doing, and I'm going to let you put that log over there. And it, geese is all about congratulating, all the noise, right? Congratulating everybody on the job that they're doing. That's the whole concept of the book. She turned the plant around to the number one plant in the country. She was brought to the White House and given an award at the White House for doing it. It's a great little story, but that's what we need to do, right? We got to trust each other. We got to work hard. Treat the janitor the same respect as the CIO, CEO. I'm an IT guy, so I see CIO all the time. We've got to understand that we've got to respect each other. And everybody's job is important, right? I don't care if you got to clean toilets. Somebody's got to clean the toilets. And that's a pretty important job. I don't like going into a dirty bathroom all the time. So let's talk about work ethics, because really this is where the rubber hits the road. The people that work hard and smart win over the people that don't. So work harder and smarter than everybody else. I'm going to share a little tidbit here. So I'm going to tie in some of the angler piece or the professional piece along with professionalism. Because I get a lot of people that ask me, what are the things that I can do? And I'm going to have a slide that I share with you, how you move up in the ranks. We'll talk a little bit about presentations and what you can put in and how to do that. One of the things that happens here with work ethics is guys that have a tendency to move up the ladder get complacent. They get a little lazy. And it's an in for a lot of the new guys all the time. So what I mean by that is, let's say me as an angler, we'll use me as an example so we don't point at anybody. So Jimmy Bell just got a 3-year contract. And it's a good contract. And I'm looking, I'm going, how am I ever going to get up to where these guys are getting to? Normally what might happen is the first year, I just got this contract, and boy, I better show value to these people, right? I'm going to work my butt off, and I'm going to make sure to show value through that first year, and I'm going to do everything that I said I was going to do, and they're going to look at you and say, awesome, great. So I got a 3-year contract, second year comes along, and all of a sudden I go, I got another year before my contract's up. I'll just kind of coast along the second year. If you're doing number one here and somebody's coasting along, guess what the sponsors are going to do? They're going to look at Josh and say, that Josh's been working his ass off. We need to get guys like that up here. You know, Jimmy's just kind of coasting along. Now, you're never going to know what years those are. You don't know when year two is of my contract. But if I'm doing that and you're working harder and smarter, they notice that, right? Because guess what's going to happen the third year? Third year comes along and I know my contract is up, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to work my ass off again because I know I got to re-sign that contract. So there's these little holes that are in the middle that if you're working harder and smarter, you will get there. Set stretch goals and track against them. Two of the guys that have helped me in this industry probably more than anybody when I got started, Scott and Marty Glorigan. I don't know if you guys all know them. They run Gemini Sports Marketing, two of the brightest individuals that I've ever been around in this industry. Got more respect for them than probably anybody else in the industry. I was blessed that they kind of took me under the wing. But one of the things they taught me early on is to set goals. Talk about stretch goals. So I'll use business as an example. And I know Mr. Keller will understand this greatly. So I set a stretch goal at work. I manage a budget of about $40 million at work. Maybe $23 million of that is expense. And I tell my guys, I said, you know what? I want you guys to work this year and cut $200,000 out of the expense budget through the year. We're not going to identify it. It's a goal of ours. We want to cut $200,000. You guys come in, you cut $175,000 out. We all pat each other on the back and we say, great job. We just saved $175,000. But if I push you further and say that I'm going to cut $300,000 out of that budget, we're going to make it a stretch goal. And everybody goes, ooh, I don't know if we make $300,000. 9 times out of 10, what's going to happen is you're going to come in and save me $250,000. So instead of $175,000 or $180,000, you save $250,000, but just by changing our goal, just by making it that stretch goal that goes beyond there. Glorvin's taught me early in this whole thing, set goals and track against them. Am I great at it? No. Do I do it? Yes, I do. Is it okay to be the person who people look to for help? Your turn will come. I'm going to talk about Mark Schutz. MS is Mark Schutz, a good friend of mine here. Took them fishing this fall. We were down the Mississippi River where the St. Croix comes in. You want to do some late fall fishing. We had a chance to be in the boat. As a promotional leader for Alumacraft, I've been looking for some guys in certain areas. I was talking to Mark. Mark used to help with the marketing managing at Lund Boats. So we're talking about individuals, and he starts talking about a guy. He says, Jimmy, I remember this guy. He said, I swear to God, every show we came to, he was there. He's carrying catalogs. He's got stuff. He's running back and forth. We need something. He goes, gets it. He starts talking about this guy. Well, guess what I'm going to say? What's his name? So what happens is this stuff comes around. When you start doing all that extra work, people notice it. They truly do. Your turn will come. So I'll use another example. I've used him in every one. I hope he doesn't get mad at me. But his name is George Federer. Many of you probably know him. He's does the test rides for Ranger boats. So that test ride boat that goes around, George drives that. I was with Ranger for a long time. Knew George well. We called him Ever Reliable George. If you needed something, he would be there. I don't care where you needed him to be, he was going to go. I mean, he's just a workhorse. Well, what's he doing now? He's selling Ranger boats. His time came. You put the effort in, people will notice and it will come around. Report on what you're doing and thank all involved. One of the things that has moved me along as far and as I've been is reporting what's going on. Communicating with your sponsors. I'll use a specific example. 96, I started with Yamaha. Probably 98, I had a meeting down at corporate in Kennesaw, Georgia. At the time, the guy was Johnny Borden, was running the Yamaha pro staff. And I go down there. I'd only been with him for 2 years. He sets me down. He says, Jimmy, how are things going? I said, great. He says, what you looking at for next year for programs? I said, you know what? I just appreciate everything that you've done for me. I really don't need to change. I'm thankful for where I'm at right now. He looked at me, he says, why is that? I said, what do you mean? He says, Yamaha is going to pay somebody a lot of money. We always do. Why shouldn't it be you? I thought about it. I said, I guess I never thought about it that way. He says, I'm going to help you with this. He says, I'm going to show you who's our number one paid pro staff guy. Cool. He opens up his drawer, great big drawer with all kinds of files. He says, I want you to go grab the thickest file out of that drawer. So I go grab the thickest file. He looks at it, says, yep, that's our number one paid guy on the staff right there. He says, grab number two. Grab number two, biggest file in there. He says, yep, that's our number two paid guy. Both names were not guys that were winning all the tournaments. Both names were people that were communicating with them all the time and telling them what they're doing and what everybody else is doing. It's important to report back what you're doing. I will do a report after this show to all my sponsors. How do I ever advance? This is my wife, Allie. Anybody that don't know my wife, Allie? That is, Stephen saw this. I think you were even thinking about coming down that day. We were up on Mille Lacs Lake. She caught these two over 6 pound smallmouth in about 5 minutes before I even got one. So needless to say, I took a lot of grief over that. But she likes to fish. She likes to fish the big red tails for the big smallmouths. So that's our new tiller. Find a niche where it plays to your strengths. All of us need to add value. What a sponsor looks for is somebody that in the end is going to ring a till someplace, right? Somehow we have to impact sales. Being a great angler doesn't always do that. It can. I'm not saying you got to work a show, right? It's not all about working a show or sitting in front of the consumer all the time. It may be that you're an idea guy. You know, maybe Nancy's great at coming up with ideas. She's just got that mind that it's able to do that. And there's value with that, right? Because we're going to get a new product when we do that. There's value with being the best angler. If you're getting stage time all the time and you get TV coverage, there's branding that goes on with that. There are times that it's about branding. I'm a brand new company, I'm making brand new rods, and I just need to get my product out there. So I just need somebody running the product. It's not about the sale at the end, but eventually it's going to turn into a sale. Find your niche. Mine has been working shows and working with consumers. I love doing that. Business value will get you further than just being a great angler. This day and age, back in the early 90s, being a great angler moved you up the ladder pretty quick, right? Everybody was looking for great anglers when it was doing that. Now they're looking for the whole package. They want business value. They want to know that you understand the business side as well as the fishing side of this whole thing. Understanding both, working with both, knowing that you can impact sales makes a difference. Promote the team, social media, and events. Don't just promote yourself. If you're part of a promotional team, maybe I'm going to share that Reed's going to be at a show for Alumacraft up at Grand Rapids at Grand Rapids Marine. I need to share that as much as somebody else. Understand you need to help your teammates as well, because what's going to happen? They're going to help you, right? In the end, you're all going to win. Create content, just don't share content. We're going to talk a little bit about social media. I'm not going to say that I'm a master at it, but I will tell you things that I know for a fact do not work right. So let's say, I'll use a recent example. I belong to Humminbird, Minn Kota, Talon on their freshwater pro staff. And I get an email and says, we've got a new promotion out. We'd like everybody to share it. Cool. Guess what happens? Say there's 50 people on that email. 45 people in the next hour grab that email, share it to everybody out on Facebook and go, ha, did my job, doing great. And I look at it and go, 45 people just dropped an ad out there. They have no content on the top of it, nothing to go along with it. They just shared it because somebody told them to share it. There's zero value with that. Number one, if you're going to do that, tag something up on the top. Personalize it. You know what? I see that, I know that some of you guys have been looking at the new Altera, and I see that Minn Kota's got a $112 rebate on the 112. It's a great opportunity. Maybe you should take a look at it. At least you've added something to personalize it at the beginning, right? But the key here is sharing content. How many people in here have seen the video of the mink for Keith Cavias? I'm guessing most people, right? Pretty cool. That's creating content, right? He created content that everybody loved. Now, did I share that? You bet your butt I shared it because it's pretty cool. You don't get to see that every day. But creating content is the key, not just sharing content. People want you to create, not just share. Anybody can share. Make yourself available to consumers always. This is a tough one. So I've got a wrap truck. On the side of my truck, I got my name. I do that on purpose. To me, that tells my sponsors that I have enough integrity and trust in myself that I will put my name on there because I'm not going to run somebody off the road. I'm not going to be a butthead because they're going to be able to look at my name. What that creates is I go to a gas station. I just had an event, and we're out there, and Reed kicked my butt. And he took first place. I missed the bite. I just was crap. And I'm right about here right now. And I'm driving home, I pull into the gas station, the guy sees, he says, hey, I've been thinking about those Alumacraft boats, and I know I got catalogs in there, and I know I should sit down and talk to this guy, but I really don't want to. I just got my butt kicked. So I get in the truck, yeah, you know, great, you should go see a dealer, and I drive off. Got my name on the side of the truck. Now, what could happen? That guy says, you know what? That Jimmy Bell's kind of a I'm going to write a note to Alumacraft and let them know because I got my name on the side of that boat. And then he writes a note and says, hey, I just want you to know that I was thinking about buying an Alumacraft boat. Pulled into a gas station, wanted to talk to one of your guys. Jimmy Bell was the name on the side of his truck. He wouldn't even take time of day for me. Poof, I'm gone. Just like that. That quick. The right thing to do is sit there and spend the time with the guy. I am not here to tell you if you do that, he is not going to go, that Jimmy Bell was a great guy, I'm going to write a note to Alumacraft, let him know that he spent time with me and I'm going to go buy a boat. You'll never hear that. But the other side you will hear immediately. Spend the time, take the time. Be happy, nobody likes a crab ass. It just amazes me in this industry, we get to do some of the most amazing things in the world, go out and fish. All the clients that you've got out there, I know some of them aren't the nicest guys, right? But you probably can't be a crab ass all the time, or you're not going to stay in business. There's a reason you two are some of the best guides that we've got out there, because people want to be with you, right? Don't be a crab ass. Successes. I'm going to talk about what's worked, and then the next slide I'm going to tell you what hasn't worked. These, are just my experiences. This is my daughter, Chelsea, on the right-hand side. I fished the AIM events with her last year and the year before. Pretty awesome. keep my family and faith in check. I learned this early on, and I've watched in our industry many people go out, get divorced, start cheating on their wives. Bad things happen. They haven't kept their family in check. Two most important things, your faith and your family, not the fishing. That is third. Understanding the value that I can provide. So I need to know what are the things that I can do for my sponsors and how can I do that, and I need to do it. So it's knowing, taking the action, and doing. Understanding their needs when making a proposal. So I'll give you a couple hints from my friends Glorvigans. I'll use a specific example. So when I started with Ranger, I got a call from Irwin Jacobs and he shipped me out to Las Vegas. Genmar had their national dealer meeting in Las Vegas. From there, decided that I was going to go down to Flippin and do a presentation for Ranger. And it was for Randy Hopper, Keith, Bart, and George Little. So I know that I've got four people. Can I borrow your sheet?
Sure.
I know I got four people that I'm going to do a presentation for. First thing I got to understand is why would they even be interested in me, right? No different than if I'm going into a presentation and trying to convince somebody. In this case, they had contacted me, but it's no different the other way around. The first thing I want to understand is what are their needs and what do I got to do to fulfill these needs? At that time, I knew that Ranger was trying to get into the Riata line. They want to do the 1850 Riata. They started to understand that their competition isn't necessarily Skeeter or Triton or anybody else. Their competition at the time was Lund, was Alumacraft, was Crestliner. What they're trying to do is grow their pie, right? So I put my presentation based on what I believed were their needs. And I sit down. Now I go into this presentation. Guess what's going to happen if I got the whole thing and I give it to the guys? Where do they go right off the bat? Go to the back page. Let's see what, okay, he's looking for that. They go to the financial page and they want to look and see what you're asking for, right? Right off the bat. So what they're going to do is make a decision based on that financial page before they have even listened to your presentation on what you can do to help them. So what do? You give them your presentation, you keep the financial pages in a separate folder and you set them to the side. Now we're going to go through the presentation. They can't go to the back page and look at the financials. We get through the presentation. I pull out my other folder. Now you got to find a new staple. I give you the number sheet, and they look at that sheet. And here's the advice from Glorvigans when I do that. Now that you've given them the financial sheet, what do? I am actually asking for everything. Never, ever do a proposal and say, what do you guys think? What do you think you can do for me? You do that and they will look at you and shake their head and go, what do you mean? I don't want to do the work to figure that out. You tell me what you think your value is. Always go in and ask for what you think that value is. Do not assume that because somebody's here, you can be here. Do it to where you think it's fair to you. The value that is right is the value that you believe is right for what you're providing, not what somebody else believes, not anything else. So now I've given you that sheet. Here's the little trick. I say nothing, zero. I sit in the chair. I don't care if I got to count holes, is what Scotty said. If you got to count holes in the tiles in the ceiling, you count holes in the tiles in the ceiling. You keep your mouth shut until they react to it. So if they go like this, push off the table, go, huh, there's no way in heck we can do something like that. That's crazy to think that. Where did you get a number like that? You missed the mark, right? But if you've gone through this proposal and they're going, yeah, you know, you get to a bullet point, yeah, we do need help with that, and they're nodding their heads, you're probably hitting pretty close, right? So now you give it to them, you're keeping your mouth shut, but if they push back from the table and they go, oh, God, we've never done anything like that. I don't know if we can do that. If they've got there, you're spot on. Spot on. If they grab that piece of paper, sign their name to the bottom, go like that, you undershot big time, right? You go, oh, God, I could have got more. I should have sold my house for $400 instead of $120. But when you go in, understand their needs when making the proposal. Give them a number. Don't make them think through it. Be realistic about financial expenses and gains. This goes to tournament guys, guides, whatever. It is very expensive to do this stuff. Do not assume you're going to go in, you're going to book a guide trip every day, you know, two a day for the rest of your life. Be realistic about what the finances are going to be. I see too many people that max out credit cards and get in trouble. Working to help build up those around me. We talked about this. If I can help move somebody from here to here and I'm here, that's great. Don't always concentrate on trying to build yourself up. Build the others around you.